morning, good morning. Catch on Fire Ministry. Good morning. We're going to start our service right now, and we're going into our welcome. I want to welcome you once, welcome you twice, and welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And we'll have a prayer by Sister Jasmine. Come on, Sister Jasmine.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. We are standing on holy ground, and I know that there are angels all around. So let us praise Jesus now, for we are standing in his presence on holy ground. Let us all stand for prayer. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Dear gracious and eternal, most righteous Heavenly Father, as we come before your throne this morning, Father, we just want to praise you. We just want to thank you, Lord God. We just want to elevate you for who you are. God, without you, we are nothing, Lord. Father, you said in your words, oh God, for your son came on this earth and he will crucify, God, for our sin, because he knew no sin, but he became sin for us. And God, we thank you because of you. We have a hope. We have a future this morning, God. Father, we might be few in numbers, God, but you said, Father God, we are one or two is gathered. Your Holy Spirit is here. And we thank you for this Spirit, God. For Father, you know we are going into the east and we're going into land, God. And Father, we pray, oh God, as you have left in the earth and went to heaven, you give us your Spirit. And your Spirit is dwell within us, God. So we say we are grateful. We honor you because you're so merciful. Many of us have faced so many tribulation this week. Father, we had families and friends, so many obstacles, so many this thing that happened, God. And we may be wondering, Lord, where are you? But God, you said in your word, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principality, against powers, and against all wickedness in high places, God. We pray, God, this morning, God, that you come nigh here in our service this morning and touch each and every one of us individually and collectively this morning, God. Father, you said, let us, oh God, forget those things that so easily beset us, God, and look towards the author and finisher of our faith. So let us look to you this morning, God. Let us cry out to you this morning in spite of what is going on in our life. God, we are not going to give up. You didn't give up on us, oh God. God, you came to earth and you gave your life for us. And there's nothing we can do this morning but just accept you and praise you and worship you because you did it all for us. We just want to say thank you, God. We just want to say hallelujah to you, God. We lift you up this morning. You deserve all the praise. And God, as the children come this morning to sing, to worship, God, for you and your glory and the adults, God, I pray, oh God, those who are listening at this point are those who will be listening later, God. We pray that your Spirit go forth, piercing even the hardest heart asunder this morning, God. Touch them this morning. Even those, oh God, who are suffering some form of ailment. Father, we pray for them this morning. We declare and declare this morning that God, we are healed because you said by your words that in your stripes we are healed. So we declare, God, we are healed this morning. And we are going to look to you, God, who is our health and our strength. We thank you. And as we're about to leave your throne, but not from your presence, May your Holy Spirit abide with us as Pastor come later to bring your word. Touch her vocal cord, God. Anoint her, Lord, that the words that she preached this morning will let someone come to know you as your personal Savior. Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Miss Jasmine. Wonderful prayer. Wonderful prayer. We're going into our praise and worship with the kids.
I'm forgiven because you're forsaken. I'm accepted, you are condemned. I'm alive and well, you spit is better than me, because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven, because you are forsaken. I'm accepted, condemned, and I'm alive and well, this spirit is better than me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you are my key, should die for me? Amazing love.
Amazing love.
If you've been walking the same old walk for the same old mile, if you've been hearing the same old voice telling the same old lies, if you've been trying to feel the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a saving, he's a prison shaking saver. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of the day, of dead of night. We have found ourselves when our souls are the same old mind. We have all one thing we do, it's the same one. When there's a better life, there's a better life. If you got pain, keep your pain taken. Lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking saver. If you got chains, well, he's a chain breaker. You can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, you receive it. If you can feel it, somebody testify.
Thank you, children, for the praise and worship. Now we're going to prejudice with what Ad does.
You can make it. Hold on. Hold on. Everything. options of you. I'm trying to pray, but where are you? I'm all churched out, hurt and abused. I can't think what left to do.
Tell the truth is I'm weak.
No strength to fight. No tears to cry. Even if I tried, but still my soul refuses to die. One touch will change my life. Take me to the King. I don't have much to bring. My heart is torn. People's pain. So Lord, speak right now. Let it fall like rain. Oh yeah, we're desperate. Much to bring. My heart is torn to pieces. It's my offering. Lay me at the throne. Leave me there alone to gaze upon your glory.
Take me to the King.
Wonderful singing. Wonderful. Hallelujah. Wonderful. Yes, it was. We're going to our catch on 5 minutes, who we are with Miss Stacy. Come on, Miss Stacy, who we are.
Catch on Fire Ministries, who we are. Goal. The Apostle Paul stated that the work of the Christian church is to build up the body of Christ so that all may become mature Christians. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 through 13. Catch on Fire Ministries is committed to fulfilling the scripture. Our mission is to draw people to Christ and enable them to continually grow into being like Christ. Vision. Catch on Fire Ministries is composed of disciples and led by disciples. Affiliations. Catch on Fire Ministries is an affiliate of Church of God of Prophecy, Buckley, St. Kitts. This church falls under the leadership of Bishop Lionel Philip Webb. Worship time, Sundays 9:30, Sunday morning worship, Wednesdays 6:30, discipleship class, fellowship, Saturday 11 a.m., praise and worship team practice.
Thank you, Stephanie, Stacy. Welcome our visitor, even though we don't have no visitor, but anytime you're inside of this Catch on Fire Ministry, you're welcome. And then we're going to offering.
Bless those who can't give. Bless those who can give, in Jesus' name. Tear down Satan's stronghold, in Jesus' name. And to build Jesus' kingdom, in Jesus' name. Ways to give. Online, catchonfireministries.org. Zelle, COFM 1013, at protonmail.com. Offering scripture, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 through 7. Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion of, for God loves a cheerful giver. Amen.
It's prayer time. We can all come to the altar. Our prayer will be led by our pastor.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father and God, we ask for your blessings and your anointing on all who are gathered here around this altar. We pray, dear God, that you cancel all the plans of the enemy in your name, Jesus. Right now, in the name of Jesus, we declare and decree that we have the victory over all the circumstances in our life. In the name of Jesus, we declare that no weapon formed against us is going to prosper. In the name of Jesus, we declare that our children are doing well. In the name of Jesus, these children are excelling at school, at home, at play, whatever they do, Lord. Touch them. Let them know that you love them. Make ways for them where they seem to be no way. Be with us, the adults, dear God. We thank you, dear God, for showing us grace and mercy and favor. We thank you, dear God, in the name of Jesus, because our debts are canceled. In the name of Jesus, our debts are being paid in full. Now we have no financial problems right now in the name of Jesus, because you're working it out, because we're giving you of our best, and you said that you must ask of you. And so, Lord, we say, give us this day our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread. Whatever it is that we need, we look to you because you're a good, good Father and you care about us. Lord, we thank you for opening doors. We want to thank you for making way. Lord, we thank you for making the crooked places straight. We want to thank you, to God, because the valley is in bloom. Oh, hallelujah. We want to praise and thank you for everything. We ask that your Shekinah glory will continue to rest on the service. We want to thank you for the praise and worship, everything that has gone forth. Oh, we thank you so much for your anointing that has been so present here and continue to be with us in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor. We're going into the scripture reading with Miss Jazz.
Our scripture reading this morning, Jesus, death, and burial. Temple veil is torn in two. Earthquake, holy people resurrected. Matthew 27:51-53. At that moment that the curtain of the temple was torn in two from the top to bottom, the earth shook and the rock split. And the tomb broke open. The bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tomb after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many people. The centurion, surely he was the Son of God. Matthew 27:54, Luke 23:47-48. When the centurion and those with him who were scorning Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and explained, surely he was the Son of God. The centurion, seeing what had happened, praised God and said, surely this was a righteous man. When all the people who had gathered to witness this sight saw what took place, they beat their breasts and went away. The woman stayed with Jesus to the end. Matthew 27:55-56, Mark 15:40-41. Many women were there watching from a distance. They had followed Jesus from Galilee to care for his needs. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's sons. Some women were watching from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James the younger, and Joseph and Salome.
In Galilee, these women had followed him and cared for his need. Many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem were also there. The soldiers break thief's leg, pierce Jesus' side. John 19:31-37. Now it was the day of preparation, and the next day was to be a special Sabbath. Because the Jewish leaders did not want the body left on the cross during the Sabbath, they asked Pilate to have the legs broken and the bodies taken down. The soldiers therefore came and broke the leg of the first man who had been crucified with Jesus, and then those of the other. But when they came to Jesus and found that he was already dead, they did not break his leg. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced Jesus' side with a spear, bringing a sudden flow of blood and water. The man who saw it had given testimony, and his testimony is true. He knows that he will tell the truth, and he testifies so that you also may believe. These things happen so that the scriptures will be fulfilled. Not one of his bone will be broken. And as another scripture said, they will look on the one they have pierced. Joseph asked Jesus' body. Matthew 27:57-58, Mark 4:15-42-45, Luke 23:50-52, John 19:38-39. As evening approached, there came a rich man from Arimathea, named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate ordered that it be given to him. It was preparation day, that is, the day before the Sabbath, so as evening approached. Joseph of Arimathea, a prominent member of the council who was himself waiting for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. Pilate was surprised to hear that he was already dead. Summoning the centurion, he asked him if Jesus had already died. When he learned from the centurion that it was so, he gave the body to Joseph. Now there was a man named Joseph, a member of the council and a good and upright man, who had not consented to the decision in action. He came from Judean town of Arimathea, and he himself was waiting for the kingdom of God. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body. Later, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Now, Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly he feared the Jewish leader. With Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, this man who earlier had visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus bought a mixture of myrrh and aloe, about 75 pounds. Joseph and Nicodemus prepared Jesus' body and laid in the tomb. Matthew 27:59-60, Luke 23:53-54, John 19:39-42. Joseph took the body wrapped in a clean linen cloth and place it in his own new tomb that he had cut out for the rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance to the tomb and went away. Then he took it down, wrapped it in linen cloth, and placed it in a tomb to cut in the rock, one in which no one had yet been laid. It was preparation day, and the Sabbath was about to begin. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, the man who earlier had visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds. Taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it with the spice in strips of linen. This was in accordance with Jewish burial customs. At the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden, and in that garden, a new tomb, in which no one had ever been laid. Because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. The woman observed where Jesus is laid. Matthew 27:61, Mark 15:47, Luke 23:55-56. Mary Magdalene
and the other Mary were sitting there opposite the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where he was laid. The woman who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph and saw the tomb and how his body was laid in it. Then they went home and prepared spices and perfumes. But they rested on the Sabbath day in obedience to the commandments. Pilate set a guard around the tomb. Matthew 27:62-66. The next day, the one after preparation day, the chief priests and the Pharisees went to Pilate. "Sir," they said, "we remember that while he was still alive, that the deceiver said, 'After 3 days, I will rise again.' Also, give the order for the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may come and steal the body and tell the people that he has been raised from the dead. This last deception will be worse than the first." "Take a guard," Pilate answered. Go, make the tomb as secure as you know how." So they went and made the tomb secure by putting a seal on the stone and posting the guards. End of scripture.
Amen, amen. Thank you, Sister Jasmine. We're going into the sermon of introduction song with the adults.
Sparrow can fly.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Yes. Now we're going into our sermon with our pastor, Dr. Novella. So preach the word.
Lord. Bless the Lord. Today is officially Palm Sunday. I have been preaching since last month on Jesus' journey, this last week, this Passion Week. And what Jasmine read so beautifully, last week we got up to where he died. It was 3 o'clock. Now what happened after he died? Because a lot of times you go from Palm Sunday straight into he's risen. And a lot of stuff happens. So I've been trying to share that with you, the journey that Jesus took. And so we're going to go right up to Resurrection Morning, just before Resurrection Morning. Next week, Sunday, is Easter Sunday. And I was reading, and they said that the last time Easter Sunday was in March was the year 2013, 8 years ago. Because Easter Sunday occurs the first Sunday after the first full moon of spring. Tomorrow is the first full moon of spring. The next time they say that Easter Sunday is going to fall in March, it's going to be 50 years from now. Those children, so it's a special Easter Sunday. You know, it's not normally this early. These children, God's willing, will live to see it. I doubt I will. I'm 59. It's not going to happen. You know, that I see another Easter Sunday in March. So let us value this opportunity. It's a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity next week, Sunday, our blessed Easter Sunday.
Pray.
Oh, Heavenly Father, the God, we ask for your blessings and your anointing as we look back on the sacrifice that you made over more than 2,000 years ago, so that we could become one once again with you, that we could be called the children of God, brothers and sisters in Christ. We ask for your anointing on the word. We pray, dear God, that it will go forth with power, that chains will be broken, that people's lives will be touched and changed, that we'll become the disciples that you want us to be, in your name, Jesus. So we're at this point where Jesus has said, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. You know, no one took his life. He gave it up. When he was ready, he just said, okay, I'm done. Over and out. Like they said, now mic drop. It was done. He was moving on. You know, and the next day was the Sabbath. So according to Moses' law, he could not be left hanging on the cross into the Sabbath day. And what we're going to walk through is what took place from then to when Jesus was in the tomb. And the Bible tells us that the veil of the temple was rent from top to bottom. And this veil was hiding the Holy of Holies. Now the Holy of Holies, only once a year did anyone go in there. And that was the high priest to seek for forgiveness of the sins, first for himself, then for his family, and then for the whole nation of Israel. And this Holy of Holies, both in the tabernacle, when they were in a tent, and when they built the temple, was a perfect cube. It was 30 feet all the way around, 30 feet tall, all the sides were 30. And there was a veil that hung 30 feet down, so no one could see into it, because the Ark of the Covenant was in there. And you can't look on God's face and live. When Moses asked to see his face, he said, I'm going to hide you in the cleft of the rock. And when I've passed, then you could look on the back of me. But no one can look at my face and live. And he said that he would appear in that tabernacle so that no one could drop dead. The veil was there. But you have to understand, 30 feet up is probably the height of this building. And the scripture said the veil was torn from top to bottom, starting from the top. So it had to be the hand of God that took it down, because no human being could have easily, and it was torn in two. So it wasn't like a little hole. It was left, right, have a look. Because you don't need to sacrifice anymore. these sacrifices all through the centuries that have you been doing. The perfect Lamb of God has been slain because we're not able to have communion. We don't need a priest to pray for us. We don't need anyone to intercede for us. He said that we can come as we are and he will hear prayer. He's a prayer hearing and answering God. And the next thing that happened is that the earth shook. And the rocks split open and the tombs broke open. And the Bible says that the bodies of many people were resurrected, holy people, on that same Sunday that Jesus resurrected. You have to understand that this earthquake, I've lived through earthquakes, and they're not fun. The earth opened up and swallowed a house. We've lived through, remember in 1970-something in my country, it was a terrible earthquake. I remember waking up and everything is shaking. But this earthquake was a specific earthquake. It didn't touch anything in Jerusalem. It didn't touch anything on Calvary. All it did was, those days they buried people in rocks. The tombs were made out of stone. All it did was broke those rocks open so that on Sunday morning they could get up with Jesus. And these are people who had recently died, because the Bible said they went into Jerusalem and people recognized them. It wasn't people from centuries ago. So Jesus was showing to some of his friends, to some of the people who are truly worshiping, I'm going to raise you up again. Resurrection power. I'm going to bring you back to life. So people could know that I'm truly the Son of God. I didn't just come for me to rise again. I've come so everybody can live again. We're living again because Jesus came and died. And he made preparation. He's a God who does things in order. He broke the tombs they opened then. So that nobody, they wouldn't be in there knocking and saying, let me out. They could just walk out. That's what God does. He cares about people. And he did them a favor. Just like he's done for us. We are now walking free. Free from the bondage of sin. You know, you can't catch me again. You know, I'm no longer a slave to sin. We have been delivered from the hands of the enemy. The things we used to do, we're not doing them no more. We're walking in victory. Ah, we know Jesus. And the centurion said, this is the Son of God. Now, a centurion was a commander of over 80 to 100 Roman soldiers. He was at the cross and he was in charge. He wasn't doing any of the hard work. He was just making sure that the soldiers did what they were supposed to do. And he had just witnessed the impossible. The sun cannot have an eclipse on a full moon. And the whole world had gone dark from midday to 3 p.m. That was the first thing he saw. And then this earthquake that only doing what God wanted to do. No buildings coming down. Nothing else shaking. Just these tombs opening up. And he said, surely. He didn't say this was the King of the Jews which was on the post. He said, this has to be God. This has to be the Son of God. He began to worship this Gentile who, unlike the Jews, didn't know that God had led his people out of Egypt. But he knew, and he had to say the original Greeks, he said the Son of a God, because he didn't know who Jehovah Jireh was. He didn't know the God we serve. But he knew this was nothing ordinary. He was in the presence of the supernatural. He was in the presence of Jesus. And here we have a Gentile worshiping Jesus. Gentiles came at his birth. They showed up and said, Herod, who is he that is born? Where is he that is born? King of the Jews. The wise men showed up and Herod got mad. And here again, someone is here, a Gentile. God is signifying, because we're Gentiles. We're not God's chosen people, the Jews, that it doesn't matter. If you want to worship, you're free to worship. And the people who had been mocking and laughing, the Bible said they beat their breasts. That means they were ashamed. They were sorry. You know, shame on them, as we would say, home. Because they realized that they had been wrong. Because God showed up for his people. I've seen God show up for us. I've seen so many people say to me, oh, Novi, I thought you were done with. But God shows up for his people. And they said they went away. Because now they realized when they were busy saying, oh, if you're the Son of God, come down, that they were wrong. Because he is the Son of God. And will always be the Son of God. And so the devil thought he had us. But we too have been set free. Let's, like the centurion, worship him. We've come to worship him. We've come to praise him. Let's give God all the honor, all the glory, all the praise. The songwriter said, I can't keep it to myself. You know, I got to tell somebody who Jesus is. I can't, you know, it's like fire shut up on the inside. It's something real that has happened to us. You know, I want to praise him. I want to thank him. When our soul look back and wonder how we got over. You know, they said we wouldn't make it. They said we'd never amount to anything. But we're here today. We're still here. And we're in God's holy plan. He's got us in the palm of his hand. And he's making a way for us. And the woman stayed with Jesus until the end. You know, and I want us to notice there was men who wrote these gospels. And they wanted us to know that the woman stayed until the end. They didn't hide the fact that they weren't there and say, oh, that can make us look bad, so let me not mention. Plus, they were in more danger than the woman. From then even to today, they probably would have been killed as co-conspirators. So they had to hide because the Romans would have taken out anybody who they say was working with Jesus. But nobody afraid of women, even though they should be. They were not. So the women were allowed to follow Jesus all the way, you know. And this woman, every time we hear about Mary Magdalene, from whom he cast out 7 demons, and it is said she must have been a very wealthy woman, because from the time that Jesus healed her, she followed him. She went everywhere he could, you know, and until the 2nd century, they used to call her the Apostle Mary. But some brilliant people in the 2nd century, they said God couldn't have a female apostle, so they stopped doing it. You know, people like to decide who God could use and who God could not use, you know, and God is not listening to anybody. I'm telling you, some of the only religions that are still around, the Methodists and the Moravians, from the very beginning, they appoint pastors, both female and male, and that's who God has blessed. There are other denominations who like to say, oh, God don't want to use a woman, and history has taken them out. You know, they're no longer here. Apparently, God ain't get the memo yet that only men he want to use, you know, because it's not true. God is not going to despise your offering. God don't have any special group that he's going to say, I don't care how much you're trying and worshiping, I'm sticking with this crew over here. That's not true. Otherwise, David would not have become king. He picked up, what Paul said, he picked up the ones that nobody wants, the despise, the people who want to serve him, who, you know, God, I just want to say to all of us, and I'm a living witness, the things that the places that I have been, I should not have gone there according to the man. But God is willing and able, and he wants to bless us. But we got to give him the best of our lives. It's what he says, if you sow sparingly, you're going to reap sparingly. If you sow with all that you have, then he'll give you all that, more than you could even imagine. You know, I keep talking about this woman who Jeff Bezos on Amazon divorce, and she said all the money that he gave her, I forget how much it was, but it was several billion dollars. She says she's gonna give it away until she don't have a dime. And she's been giving, everybody's been complaining, because she's been giving to people who don't normally get, like historically black universities and college, and she's not asking for any help. And I'm here to tell you today that as much money as she has given away, she has the same amount. because the price of Amazon keep going up. It's like God keeps saying, you keep giving, I'm going to keep giving it back to you so that you could keep giving more. We got to learn to give. He said the blessing is more blessed to give than to receive. I'm a living witness. I'm telling you, I've been down, real down, you know, but God has brought me back out. He's no matter what, he said, just man falls 7 times, but he riseth again. You know, because he's going to stay with us. Things not always going to be perfect. You know, things, but he said he's going to give us beauty for ashes. He said he's going to make the crooked places straight. And it doesn't matter that people are against us. They were against Jesus as well. Nobody was saying it. And everybody who fell in with the crowd. Oh, look at him now. I thought he said he was the Messiah. People gonna let us down. It doesn't matter. We leave them in the hands of God. And we keep our eyes stayed on Jesus. We don't ever give up our faith. We don't ever turn our back on Jesus. Because we serve a risen Savior. No one else serves a risen Savior. It doesn't matter what they say. You know, Buddha, Muhammad, Joseph Smith, none of them can help anybody. But the God we serve, his name is Jesus, the name above all names. He's a change breaker. He's a prison shaking savior. He's come to set the captives free. I'm here today clothed in my right mind because of Jesus. Had it not been for the Lord, who knows where we would have been? We might have been dead. We might have just been in our grave. We might be in jail. But Jesus has done a great work. He that started a good work in us is well able to finish it. And the soldiers came along and they broke the thief's legs. And they pierced Jesus' side. The next day was a Sabbath. And these evil chief priests, they were like, Moses' law said that if we hang you, you have to come down by nightfall. They didn't matter to them that they had just killed Jesus, an innocent man. They had just come with a bunch of lies and made sure he was crucified. But they have to make sure. A lot of people like that, you know, oh, I have to have my hat on in church. That's what makes me holy. I don't have to show any love to anybody. I could do whatever I want as long as I have the hat on. I'm there every time church open. And we had terrible rules growing up. No makeup, no pants, no nothing. Ridiculous things, no jewelry. Nonsense. God is not into that, you know. Just looking at specific things. And so they were like, they were just like that, obeying the letter of the law, but not the spirit thereof. So they went to Pilate and told him that they need to get them down off the cross. And this, the Jews' law, God is a merciful God. If you went to how the Romans did crucifixion, you stayed up there until you were dead. And that could take 5 to 6 days. And they didn't care. During that time, they didn't give you any water to drink. So you could go stark raving mad from thirst. Because you did all to the day, all to the night. Plus, remember, they beat them before they take them there. So flies are crawling around in the open cuts on their backs. You know, it's a nasty scene. And then when they finish with you, that's why it was called the place of the skull. They just throw you down there, and our dogs and vultures, anybody could eat you, any animal that show up, they didn't care. They was to tell, set an example on you, don't mess with Rome. We're going to take you out, and we're going to take you out terribly. But if they wanted to hasten the death, they would use a big hammer, mallet, and they would break the leg of the condemned. Because remember, this was a capital T, not just how they're showing it. So the only way you could get to breathe is your legs were keeping you up so that you could breathe. So once they break your legs, your head went forward and you would smother to death because you couldn't get any oxygen into your lungs. So this is what they were saying. Get it over with. Break their legs so that they could die. And they went to the two thieves and they broke their legs. But when they came to Jesus, he was already dead. And this is why is this important? about 1,000 years before Jesus was born, David prophesied that none of his bones would be broken. And why was this important? It's because the Passover lamb, they were given specific instructions not to break any of the bones of the Passover lamb. The lamb that would rescue them from the angel of death. So this was being, and they knew that the Messiah would not have any of his bones broken. So this was fulfilling scripture. The lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. His bones also would not be broken. You know, the 24 elders cast the thrones and said, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slain, because by your blood you have purchased every nation, every tribe, and every tongue. You purchased people." And that is what we're dealing with here. The Lamb of God was slain for our sin. And they pierced his side. David, that man who walked with God, said they're going to look on him who they pierced. And apparently the soldier wanted to make sure that this man was dead. So he took his spear, and they say he went through his heart, because that if you wouldn't survive that blow if you were still living. And by piercing his heart, around our heart is water. And they say he went all the way through to the ventricles, so blood came out as well as water. And all through the ages, we have said, Spurgeon lets us know that when they did atonement for sin, they used two things, water and blood. And that's how the sins. So here again, we have Jesus doing water and blood. And in the two sacraments, baptism and the Lord's Supper, involve water and blood. So this was a testimony of what was happening, that the Lamb of God was being slain for our sin. You know, he was being slain so that you and I could go free, the spotless lamb. And Joseph went and asked for Jesus' body. Now, you must understand, I want to tell you, make sure we understand, because I didn't always know this, that Joseph of Arimathea was a member of the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin was 71 people who ran Jerusalem. It was led by the chief priests, but they were also very powerful. You had to be very powerful and very rich to be a member of this Sanhedrin. And it is said, the scripture is very clear, that when they got together and said that Nicodemus is also a member, and said that they were going to crucify Jesus, and he didn't agree. He didn't vote with them or take him down to Pilate and get him crucified. Remember the morning they started off, Caiaphas got the crew together and said, "What's the story we're going to tell Pilate? Are we going to tell Pilate that he don't pay taxes and that he say he's a king? He's a revolutionist. He's trying to take over from the emperor. Because this Pilate have to kill him after that. Because the emperor of Rome don't want no trouble. And if Pilate doesn't kill him, we're going to complain Pilate. So Pilate going to wind up dead too. So it's not in his interest to let Jesus live." So when they had that meeting of the Sanhedrin, the scripture is letting you know that it wasn't everyone who voted. Nicodemus didn't, and neither did Joseph of Arimathea. You know, so it was preparation day, the day before the Sabbath. The Jews to today, they observe the Sabbath. They don't do anything on the Sabbath. They don't cook, they don't clean. It's a day of rest. So on Friday, you have to get all your cooking done, all your cleaning done, get everything done. So it was preparation day. And so they had to get Jesus off that cross and into a tomb, because otherwise they'd have to leave him there for the next 24 hours once the Sabbath started. So to show you how powerful Joseph was, he went to see Pilate. He didn't have an appointment. Pilate wasn't ordinary. This is as though we show up and we go and say, tell Biden I'm out here to see him. Nobody going to let us in. It's certain people could get in. You know that. If they show up by and say, Sediment, let me hear what he have to say. That's how rich and powerful Joseph was. That he could show up and Pilate would say, let me hear what he has to say. And he asked for Jesus' body. And Pilate was surprised, because he know this crucifixion take 5 to 6 days to hear that he was already dead. And he was a good manager. He didn't just believe Joseph. He went and asked the centurion, is this true? Called this, and the centurion agreed, you know, that it is true. Then he said, let him take the body. And they took the body. And you have to understand, body down. And the Romans, even though they would leave the body there, if you showed up and you said, could you please let me have the body, they would give it to you. And but Jesus' relatives were poor, one. Two, they were not from Jerusalem. They were in Galilee. So there was no one there who could have taken his body. So these two men, Joseph and Nicodemus, they went and they got the permission to take Jesus' body down from the cross. And they went, like I said, you have to go to the supervisor. If they had gone to the centurion, they might not have gotten the body. They went to Pilate. Nobody dared to disobey Pilate. So they could come and say, Pilate didn't even tell them to tell him. I said, so Pilate called the centurion and said, let them take the body. So they were authorized. They were approved. And so they got the body. And we learn that they went and they prepared Jesus' body. And you must understand, myrrh is very expensive. Still very expensive. And they went, Nicodemus bought 75 pounds of myrrh and aloe. Normally, and I was surprised when I read this, they only use 1 pound to prepare the body. Nicodemus wasn't saying this is too much. Jesus, who he came to at night, he wanted to show him how much he loved him. He wasn't holding anything back. And it was an expensive mixture that he was bringing. And here again we have myrrh. When Jesus was born, the wise men brought myrrh. And so in his death, they're bringing myrrh again. And the purpose of this burial of these spices was a custom, was so that the body would take a long time to decay. And the Bible tells us, David prophesied that his body would not experience any kind of decay. So between the Friday night and Sunday morning, nothing would happen because he was totally covered. And they wrap him in strips like a mummy. And we're going to understand what that means when we get to Easter Sunday. Like a mummy they put down. But before they could do that, and they were rich, they had to clean his body. There were thorns from the crown of thorns. There was wood, splinters from the crucifixion. There was blood all over him. And they didn't call any servants. They did it themselves. They cleaned the body. They washed the body. I am very, very much not into doing anything that I don't like. And I know I would not want to do it. I applaud them. I know I didn't want to do nursing. I didn't want anything to do with anything like that because I don't want to do it. You know, I'm not interested. I don't know how my daughter became a doctor because she did not get that from me. You know, I'm telling you, I applaud y'all. I'm not interested. I'm running for my life. But they did it, and they didn't say it. They knew it was an honor to prepare Jesus' body as he was dead, and they didn't spare any expense. Joseph gave Jesus a brand new tomb in a garden. And now you must understand how wealthy this man really was. When Donald Trump's first wife died, he buried her on the golf course. Only the very rich can do that. The rest of us have to get a permit to go up to a cemetery and join a lot of other people. He had a tomb, and it wasn't an ordinary tomb. It was in a garden. A garden mean that there were walks and trees, and he had prepared it for himself. And he gave a brand new tomb that no one had ever been in. And this was important. You know, Jesus couldn't be resurrected from Calvary where all these dead bones was. God would have said, maybe it ain't Jesus, maybe somebody else really come back to life. If anybody else was in the tomb before Jesus, they would have said, oh, maybe it ain't Jesus either, maybe it's the other person. And if it was anybody, they might say, like what happened with Elijah, when the dead body touched the bones, he came to life, maybe it's the other person bring Jesus to life. You know, this ain't really no resurrection power. And Isaiah prophesied that Jesus would be buried with the rich. And we see that coming to pass here. You know, a tomb in a garden. That's, in fact, Mary asked the man if he's the gardener. Somebody was maintaining an empty spot of land with a tomb waiting for somebody to come. That's how much money that Joseph had and wasn't holding back. And in those days, they'd roll a stone, like the stone would be up on a hill and they had a groove, and once the body was in, they would roll the stone down to close the mouth. And so this is what Nicodemus and Joseph did. They closed off the tomb. They had put away Jesus. And still we find here Mary Magdalene and the other woman still following them. So they watched them take Jesus off the cross and they walked behind them. They watched them prepare Jesus for the grave and they waited on them. And then they walked behind them as they took Jesus to the tomb. Matthew said that they sat down opposite the tomb because they wanted to make sure they knew where Jesus was. They weren't giving up on him. They had been there when things were good, when he was healing the sick and raising the dead. You know, the scripture says that they came, that they looked after him in Galilee. They looked after him all the way to Jerusalem. They used to feed Jesus so he didn't have to do anything except do the good things. Whatever Jesus had done in their life, they wanted to do something for him. Every single day of their life, they didn't say this is too much. Mary Magdalene was the leader of the woman, and she never left his side. She made sure Jesus, she took all of her substance. You know, not one, not two, but seven demons were taken out of her. God knows what was happening in her life, because the devil ain't easy. He loved to embarrass you. And she gave back to Jesus. She said, I'm going to do all that I can. I'm going to worship you. There's nothing too much. Lord, just give me the opportunity to live for you, because nothing I do can compare to what you've done in my life. Oh, the song says, I am a worshiper. I am a worshiper. We're worshiping the one true God. And so they came and they followed Jesus. And even though Nicodemus had used 75 pounds, they went and prepared more. They said, it doesn't matter. I wondered to myself, how did they expect to get the stone rolled back? You know, but they had faith. They say, it doesn't matter that they have done this much. We want to still do something. God is not going to refuse my offering. And the next day was the Sabbath. So, and it was, he died at 3. Around 6, it would get dark. So they had to stop. Moses' law was very strict. I used to live across from a synagogue when I was living in Elizabeth. And that was many years ago. And the Jews don't do anything. One of the things they don't do is they don't drive on the Sabbath. So to get to church, to the synagogue rather, they can call it church, they have to walk. So on Saturday morning, you see them coming up with their babies, the wives, a long line, and the property around there was very expensive because they couldn't start walking from 10 miles away. And they had to live close enough to a synagogue to walk. So this is what it meant. Preparation day came to an end. I used to work with somebody else who was Jewish, and 11 o'clock every Friday he left the job in New York, because he, you know, especially in the winter, it's dark by 3 o'clock, And he lived all the way up in, I think, Mount Vernon. So he had to make sure he get home before it turned dark. The other days of the week, he'd work till 6, 7 to make up. But in order to observe the Sabbath, he was leaving New York by the job by 11 every Friday. And they accepted it, you know, that's which is fine. But I just want to give you the importance, how they take the Sabbath seriously. So this is Friday night, and they are preparing for their Lord. They got the spices there, and they say, Sunday morning, we can't go, they're women. The Sabbath ends Saturday at 6 o'clock, but they can't go over there in the night by themselves. So that's why they had to wait till Sunday morning early to take the spices. So they got it ready. You know, all through the centuries, we get things ready for when we're going to use them. You know, it's our job. You know, and so Sunday is coming. And then these high priests, on the Sabbath, when they're supposed to not be nothing, doing anything, show up in front of Pilate and say, this deceiver said that he was going to rise again on the third day. Calling him a deceiver, you know, the man already dead. And they're still finding bad things to say about him. They already got through the crucifixion, but they're still afraid, you know. So they said the disciples might come and steal him away. So send some guards down there. And the Bible says that he sent a Roman unit, and they sealed the tomb. When you seal the tomb with Pilate's seal, anybody who touched that tomb was going to die. It's like it's worse than where it's a police line, do not cross, because you ain't going to die if you cross. But if you cross and move that seal that is Pilate's, you are going to die. You know, and this unit had 16 soldiers in it. If one of them fell asleep, all of them would be put to death. They couldn't lean on anything. They were just supposed to stay there and stand guard. This was the elite. This was Pilate's personal guards. These weren't ordinary. This is like the Navy SEALs. You know, they didn't get there. They had passed through a lot. And they were there keeping watch. And we're going to talk about them next Sunday. You know. As important as they thought they were, you know. And so anybody who had shown up in their own strength was going to die, you know. This wasn't ordinary. This wasn't me looking to see what might happen. This is like the Navy SEALs who took out Osama. That's what was happening here. And so this is Friday, but Sunday is coming. We're going to talk about Sunday, next Sunday, Easter Sunday, when he talk about the fact that he is risen. And it is finished. The debt has been paid. You and I are here today. I'm here today because Jesus washed my sins away. I still remember. I'm 59 this year, and I still remember when I was 7 years old and Pastor Brown preached. I don't know what she was preaching, but I know I just started crying. And I came up that day, and I danced. And I remember the grass looked greener. The sky looked bluer. I was just so happy. I cried my heart out, and I know my life has never been the same. Because we've all been touched by the hand of the man from Galilee. The veil has been ripped in two so that we can all go in and rejoice and be glad. He said this is our year of Jubilee. He's come to set the captives free. He's come to make the blind see. He come to set at liberty them that has been bound. We're no longer slave to sin. You know, as they sang, the children sang, prison doors have been broken. You know, we're walking in a different place, in a different manner. You know, I don't know what my life would have been had it not been for the hand of Jesus. I know that God can make a difference in all of our lives. It doesn't matter what the devil says. The devil is a liar. And in the
of Jesus. We're coming out. Our children are coming out. It's a new season in all of our lives. The devil is a lie. It might not look that way, but our bills are paid. You know, our children are going to be all right. The devil can't have them in Jesus' name. We've dedicated them to God, and he's going to use them for his glory and for his honor. Ah, there's so much that God wants to do, and God doesn't despise anybody. The woman couldn't even testify in a court of law. No one wanted to hear them. And God allowed them to witness everything. This is what we're working with. The fact that God is not going to play favorites. I'm telling you, you know, if you come to me and the choice is you are my children, it probably be my children. You know, it doesn't matter how much better you are. I'm biased. I'm prejudiced. I'm human. That's not going to happen with God. That is not going to happen. I'm a living witness. I shouldn't be here today, but for God. I'm still here. We're still here, still holding on. This is not the end. This is just the start of where God is going to take us. They've left us for dead. You know, the people who moved on and moved out and have had their say. But God wanted them gone. I'm telling you. Because what we're doing here, when the 70 left, Jesus asked the 12, you going to go with them? And they said, no. Because we know you are the Son of God. So to form a fighting unit, you need people who are serious and committed. And we have that here. And what our children are going to see, you can't even imagine. You can't even imagine. I'm telling you. That we have hopes and dreams for children, and we don't know what the tomorrow holds, but we know who holds tomorrow. And that I know it looks dark. I've been there. No money to pay the bills, nowhere to live, but it doesn't matter. I am here to tell you that if you hold on, God is going to bring us out, that he's already brought us out. You know, it seems impossible. Don't listen to the naysayers. We got to shout now. We have to declare now. Before David killed Goliath, he said, told Goliath, I'm going to cut off your head. The birds of the air are going to eat your flesh. And the rest of the army are going to take out the rest of the Philistines. And he hadn't done anything yet. You have to write the vision, make it plain. You have to say, I'm going to pay off my bills. These Egyptians I see today, I'm not going to see them anymore because God is going to clean them up and take them out of my life. You know, my children are going to make it. They're going to be all right in Jesus' name. Because it doesn't matter about the material things. What matters is that they're worshipers. That they know to call on the name of Jesus. Because nothing else will work out things for them. And it doesn't matter. Don't listen to what the teachers have to say about your children. That you can't accept what people are saying about your children. Don't accept what people are saying about you. Only what God says matters. Whose report will you believe? We're going to believe the report of the Lord. And if you find that teachers are saying things about you, move your child. Find another school. Homeschool them if you have to. We all know the story of Ben Carson, how they told his mother that he can't read and he'll never be anything. And he became a neurosurgeon because his mother took him home and had him and started teaching him herself. Do not accept the words of the devil over our life, over our children's life. Say, I'm not that person. My children are not that people. They're who God says they are. And they're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And they're created unto good works. We are the righteousness of God. We are God's precious workmanship. We're coming out. We've already come out. God has already answered our prayer, and it's all right.
Don't fight
things going wrong or what look like they're going wrong. Give God the praise. He said, in everything, give thanks, because this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning us. Sometimes the job that we don't get is the job that we're not supposed to get. The house we don't get is the house we're not supposed to get, where we're supposed to be. You know, let's pray. Heavenly Father, no God, thank you for a day well spent in his presence. Thank you for the worshipers. Thank you for your presence that has been so real. Thank you, dear God, for your anointing. We pray that you'll enable us to live for you. We pray that these young people grow up and live the words that they sing so beautifully. You know, you are my king. Amazing love. You know, we thank you for the adults who sang so real. If this isn't love, the ocean is dry. There's no stars in the sky. We thank you for the beautiful work that you're doing here and now in all of our lives. We pray that you continue to touch lives, continue to make a difference in the lives of everyone who hears and who falls under the sound of this voice, these words, and this worship. In your name, amen. Let's say the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Thanks for joining us. Have a blessed week.